Supracondylar humerus fractures in children. In children, the supracondylar region encompasses an area of thin, weak bone located in the distal humerus. This region is especially predisposed to fracture because its configuration in two columns connected by thin bone represents a zone of weakness. Supracondylar fractures of the humerus are the most frequent fractures affecting the pediatric elbow, and happens most often to children younger than 8 years old. The fracture line typically propagates transversely across the distal humerus just above the joint. Extension and flexion are the two major types of supracondylar fracture, and each has a characteristic mechanism of injury. Extension fractures account for approximately 95% of supracondylar fractures, and typically result from a fall onto an outstretched arm with the elbow in hyperextension. The distal condylar complex may then shift in either the posterolateral or posteromedial direction. In patients with posterolateral displacement of a supracondylar fracture, the brachial artery may be injured when the proximal fragment of the fractured humerus moves medially in reaching the brachial artery. The median nerve crosses the elbow joint with the brachial artery. This displacement puts the median nerve and its anterior interosseous nerve branch at the greatest risk of injury. Supracondylar flexion fractures account for 5% of supracondylar fractures. These fractures result from a direct blow to the posterior aspect of the flexed elbow. The distal condylar complex is more likely to displace in the anterolateral direction. The ulnar nerve crosses the elbow posterior to the medial epicondyle and is typically not affected with extension-type fractures. However, it is prone to injury following flexion-type fractures. Symptoms and diagnosis. The doctor will ask how the injury occurred and will perform a focused physical examination of the involved extremity. With attention to diminished or absent pulse, neurologic deficit, signs of acute compartment syndrome, open wounds, and signs of associated fractures. The doctor should suspect the diagnosis in children with swelling and/or pain at the distal humerus with inability to move the arm or significantly limited range of motion after an extension injury, such as a fall on an outstretched hand. Non-displaced fractures may have minimal swelling, but observation will show that the child is not using the affected arm normally. Posterior distal humeral palpation is usually painful in these patients. Unstable displaced supracondylar fractures typically have marked swelling and may have an S-shaped configuration. The doctor should compare the radial pulse with the opposite limb and assess distal perfusion using capillary refill test. Initially symmetric and equal pulses with normal perfusion and skin warmth are reassuring but do not entirely exclude vascular injury. Patients with a normal initial neurovascular examination warrant regular repeated evaluation, especially immediately following splinting, fracture manipulation, or movement of the affected extremity. If a radial or brachial pulse is not palpable, a Doppler ultrasound should be used to determine the presence of distal perfusion. Brisk capillary refill, normal color, and a warm hand indicate the presence of some distal perfusion, even when distal pulses are diminished or absent. Diminished or absent pulses in association with poor distal perfusion, pallor, and a cool hand are concerning signs of ischemia, especially in association with pain upon passive extension of the fingers. Patients with these findings warrant emergency intervention to re-establish limb perfusion. The doctor should evaluate the sensory and motor function of the median, radial, and ulnar nerves while minimizing arm movement. Patients with signs of acute compartment syndrome require emergency pediatric orthopedic consultation. Signs of compartment syndrome include excessive swelling and ecchymosis at the elbow, increasing forearm pain, increased pain upon passive extension of the fingers, and a cold hand with poor perfusion, pallor, and diminished or absent pulse, late finding. Radiographic diagnosis. If a physical examination shows likelihood of a fracture, the doctor will use X-rays to confirm the diagnosis and to distinguish a supracondylar fracture from other possible types of injuries. Radiographic diagnosis of a supracondylar fracture requires anteroposterior and true lateral views of the elbow. The doctor should not permit active or passive elbow movement in a patient with a suspected supracondylar fracture until a displaced fracture has been excluded by radiography. Excessive manipulation of the extremity during radiologic procedures may further exacerbate or precipitate neurovascular injury in patients with displaced fractures. For this reason, splinting is advisable prior to obtaining radiographs. Distal neurovascular status should be checked before and after splinting. If any new decrease in pulse or neurologic deficit is found after immobilization, then the splinting material should be removed, the arm position adjusted, and the splint reapplied. A true lateral view of the elbow is essential because the majority of classifications and treatment algorithms are based on the degree of extension or flexion displacement. The main anatomical landmark to be evaluated in the lateral view is the anterior humeral line. This line continues the anterior cortical of the humerus. In a normal elbow, should traverse the capitellum in its middle third. In a displaced fracture in extension, the line will pass anteriorly or may not even cross the capitellum. In case of a flexion-type fracture, the line passes posteriorly to the capitellum. While diagnosis of displaced fractures is usually evident, diagnosis of minimally or non-displaced fractures can be challenging. The posterior fat pad sign can also be evaluated in the radiograph, which is a lucency on a lateral view along the posterior distal humerus. It is suggestive of the presence of an occult non-displaced fracture of the elbow. In most children, the fracture line is clearly seen. In very young children, the bones may not be sufficiently hardened to show up well on an X-ray. Your doctor may also request an X-ray of the uninjured arm to make a comparison. Supracondylar fracture classification. Extension-type supracondylar fractures may be further classified according to the Gartland classification system. Gartland type 1 supracondylar fracture describes a non-displaced fracture with radiographic evidence of posterior fat pad signs. The anterior humeral line transects the middle third of the capitellum. Type 2 fracture refers to a displaced fracture with an intact posterior periosteum. In contrast to type 1 fractures, the anterior humeral line is displaced anteriorly. Either hitting the anterior third of the capitellum or missing it entirely, indicating posterior displacement of the distal humeral fracture. Gartland type 3 fracture is a displaced fracture with no continuity between the proximal and distal fracture fragments. Posteromedial displacement is the most common pattern. Posterolateral is less common. The treatment. For children with adequate distal circulation and no sign of compartment syndrome, definitive care is determined by the degree of displacement on plain radiographs. Patients with a non-displaced type 1 fracture may be immobilized using a posterior splint. The splint should extend from the wrist to the axilla, with the elbow at 90 degrees of flexion and the forearm in neutral position with respect to supination and pronation. Circumferential casting and extremes of flexion should be initially avoided in most cases to decrease the incidence of compartment syndrome and vascular compromise. Neurovascular status should be checked before and after splinting. The typical duration of immobilization for this type of fractures is 3 weeks. Type 2 fractures require orthopedic closed reduction and percutaneous pin fixation. During surgery, thin pins may be put into the end of the humerus to keep the bone from moving until it heals. This procedure is called closed reduction and percutaneous pinning. Percutaneous means through the skin. A posterior splint is applied for the first week and then replaced by a cast. Type 3 supracondylar fractures and flexion-type fractures require open or closed reduction and percutaneous pinning. Open reduction is more frequently required with flexion-type fractures. Patients who are pulseless but have distal perfusion with a warm hand do well with timely operative fracture reduction and fixation. For these patients, vascular surgery is usually not needed. Patients who are pulseless and have pale and cold hand and do not have significant improvement in pulse after reduction and fixation warrant emergency vascular exploration. Once the acute compartment syndrome confirmed by compartment pressure measurement or by clinical examination by an orthopedic surgeon, immediate management includes relieving all external pressure on the compartment. Any dressing, splint, cast, or other restrictive covering should be removed. The limb should not be elevated. Elevation can diminish arterial inflow and exacerbate ischemia. Analgesics should be given. Definitive treatment consists of fracture alignment and fasciotomy to decompress all involved compartments. If a compartment syndrome is not treated in a timely manner, the associated ischemia and infarction in the forearm flexor muscles may progress to Volkmann ischemic contracture. After surgery, the arm is protected with a posterior plaster splint, applied at 45 degrees to 90 degrees of flexion for approximately 3 weeks. After surgery, most children undergo hospital admission for monitoring of pulses, nerve function, and forearm compartments. Repeat radiographs are obtained on a regular basis to assess bone healing. Pins are normally removed in the doctor's office 3 to 4 weeks after surgery. The area is then covered with a bandage that stays in place for 2 to 12 hours. There's often no need for anesthesia in this procedure, although there may be some discomfort. Children sometimes describe it as, "it feels funny," or, "it feels weird." The majority of elbow motion is recovered rapidly, usually within 2 months of splint removal. The older child may take a little longer. The prognosis for long-term outcome and function is good if the fracture is appropriately diagnosed and treated. Many of the associated complications either are self-limited or are amenable to functional repair with surgical intervention.